Boss talk. Who your girlfriend favorite? Boss talk. We gonna do it how you want it.
Check it. This is Unique Hustle. It's your boy ECEO, and I'm here with the lovely, amazing official Miss Jamaica. What's going on?
Nothing. My dad walk on.
Hey man. Hey, we got another banger for you today, man. Hey man, this guy don't need no introduction. Y'all know I always say that. I'm famous for this guy don't need no introduction, man. Hey man, what's up, Shorty 40?
What's good, man? That's 903, man.
Hey 903. What 903? Where you at out there, man? Stop playing.
I was saying, what's up with you?
You shouting at 903.
Yeah,
but I've been in 214 for a long time, man.
Yeah,
30 plus, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, I mean, my roots is all over the place, man. But this ain't about me, man, today. This ain't about me, man. This is about Shorty 40, huh? Yeah.
Where did 40 come from? I know you're not in your 40s yet.
Nah, man, you know, the 40 is actually, you know, for one, you know, I'm a big, you know, artillery, ammunition type of guy.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, all my guns mostly was hidden in the bushes, hidden behind the air compressor. You know, every time they found a gun, it was the 40. You know, but, my granny, well, my aunt, she stayed in the house off of Burning in 42nd in Los Angeles. So you see the little short red guy come by, you know, with that Creed cologne and stuff. They're like, okay, Shorty 40.
Yeah. So the Shorty, that correct. So grandma and them even know they call you Shorty 40.
Yeah.
Wow.
Grandma just say Quinn.
Quinn.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah. So man, let's get into his background a little bit. Let's find out who he really is, right? Yeah. What make him tick?
Tell us about yourself growing up.
And where you grow up at?
Well, you know, your childhood starts with fifth grade, basically. You know what I'm saying? So North Dallas, you know what I'm saying, the Wildflower Apartments. 924 units, three phases. So, you know, I always had it instilled in me, you know, to be wealthy. But three elements to get there, I already had it in my mind. One, you're either going to be a Marine. Two, you're either going to play for the Detroit Pistons.
And how old were you when you were thinking like this?
That's like 11.
Okay.
That just in my blood, you know what I'm saying? I don't know where it came from.
Detroit Pistons, and you so small?
That's the thing. You know, I'm quick with it. You know what I'm saying? Either a Marine, Detroit Pistons, or a rapper. You know, every black kid in the inner city like a rapper. You know what I'm saying? So from there, you know, I had it like an ambition. I always had to try to get some money. You know what I'm saying? I got to have some money. You know, at 11 years old, in the fifth grade, you can't work legally. So you either got to go panhandling, cut somebody's yard, rake some leaves and shit, you know, to get some money in your pocket. But you got to think about it. I'm so ambitious that I'm going to the office in the Wildflower Apartments, you know, telling the lease agents, hey, man, you got a job I can do. You know what I'm saying? I'm out of school. You know what I'm saying? She say, you know what? I like how the way you be, you know, riding your bike out here, you know, you pick up trash, you know, stuff. So I'm going to give you $20 every time the maintenance man ain't here, you know. Just to put some money in your pocket. I'm like, okay. So my granny stayed there for 9 years. So from fifth grade to about ninth grade. Fifth grade coming into sixth grade, you know what I'm saying? I was doing all that, but I started becoming big dog status in the apartment. So now from there, I know all the phases. I know who moving in. I know what's doing behind phase one. I know who doing behind phase
so
two.
So who did you get this mindset from?
Man,
like your dad, your mom?
Well, see, the thing is, my mom, she's a hard-working brainiac.
Okay.
My dad was a hustler.
Okay.
So
combination of both.
Combination of both.
Okay.
You know, so.
So what was, tell me a lesson that either one of them or both of them have ever taught you, that have stuck with you and helped you through your situations?
Okay, so I'm going ahead and initiation of that. I'm gonna say my mom, she taught me always, you know, don't depend on nobody. You know what I'm saying? Be independent. Don't take people's word for what it is. See actions before people speak. You know what I'm saying? And you know, my dad, you know, whether he on the phone or behind bars or whatever, he said, be your own man. You know what I'm saying? Customize your woman for you. You know what I'm saying? Your woman should be wearing a Louis Vuitton. She saw me wearing MCM. She saw me wearing Dior. How you say that?
Dior.
Yeah, Dior.
That shit. You know what I'm saying? I'm a Wamsley, so she should go. The $1,000 I get, go to the embroidery, get Wamsley written on there. Mm-hmm. I want to see Wamsley Purrs. I want to see Wamsley Cologne. I want to see you and me. You know what I'm saying? The other shit, that's other man shit. You mm-hmm. customize for me. You know what I'm saying? So be your own brand, be your own man, basically.
Oh, cool. I like that.
So, coming up, did you ever get in any trouble or any trouble ever knock at your door?
See, that's the thing, like I was saying. Fifth grade, sixth grade, which the hustle mentality came within me, you know what I'm saying? At 11 years old, what the hell an 11-year-old doing with $200 in his pocket? You know what I'm saying? Sixth grade coming to the summer, I got the moped my granny bought me, you know what I'm saying? I'm about to get ready to go to Franklin Middle School, you know, so I'm riding the moped, the big bank, got brakes, and back then I was like Lil Bow Wow at that time, it was like 05, 06, you know what I'm saying? They got the fresh Jordans. So in the Wildflower Apartments, the young cats was either Ethiopians or Mexicans. Most of the Ethiopians stayed in the house playing their video games. I peeped that, you know, running around. Most of the Mexicans, they kicking soccer balls and stuff. So I'm the big dog around there, but I'm basically getting money. Then you had this girl, we're gonna call her Gina, cause she a young Tisha Campbell looking like girl, you know what I'm saying? Long hair, walking around drinking Slurpees and stuff. So I got with her and had her to watch out while I go take some shit and go sell it. So the first project I had to do was watch out for me at Target while I go take this tape recorder. That tape recorder for me to record my ideas, what I want to be when I grow up. Rapping, I was fucking with the rapping back then. And me conversation with people. So it's basically a global mindset and a tape recorder all in one. You know what I'm saying? And which later on will probably produce itself to be something great. You know, that was one incident. So we stole from Target. So the second project I had her do is to steal this Hispanic guy who's a construction worker, Revival. See, I know him. See, I watch him when I ride my moped around there picking up trash stuff. I know what time he get off. I'm watching him. You know, he crack his Bud Light. He get drunk. He throw this shit on the trash. I got to pick it up. I see him walking around with bullets on the glove. Okay, got a gun. You know what I'm saying? I'm what going on 12. You know what I'm saying? And, I had her sit on the steps because in the Wildflower Apartments, when you go upstairs, you can also go back. You know what I'm saying? I had her sit on the front stairs, paint her toes and stuff, act like she's just doing girly shit while I'm back there taking this revolver and shit. But we got that. I sold that for like $100.
Actually, okay. You on the come up.
Yeah, I sold that to a Jamaican, actually, who stayed across the street from me. About 2 days later, I didn't see her. You know what I'm saying? Because I always go get her when we about to do something. She my lookout. She basically my bread and butter. You know, and I'm borrowing my moped. I'm talking to the Ethiopian. Hey, bro, you seen Jasmine? Like, they're like, no, I just see that Jasmine. You know, go look at the Mexicans. Hey, you seen the girl with the brakes? No, sir. Then one of my partners, Jeremy, you know what I'm saying? He kind of like a bookworm, you know what I'm saying? He stay in the house all the time, but he know where she be at, you know? And I'm riding my moped. He's like, Quinn, bro. Your girl bleeding. She bleeding. I'm on my moped. I'm like, where's she at? She over there, right where the gate is. Go over there. I see a black eye with her sandal kind of off, walking towards me with blood in her mouth. I'm like, what the fuck going on, bro? It's like, you know that Mexican man we stole the gun from? He did this for me. All right, okay. But, you know, now one thing about me, another thing from my hustling mentality, I was always fearless. Like, nothing scared me. I don't know what it was. I was just always fearless. Like, I had no fear in anything. So I'm looking for the dude on my moped. Still a small guy, you know, smaller than this. You know, but like I had a heart of a honey badger. You know what a honey badger mm-hmm, is? Mm-hmm. Small, tough, and able to get shit done. So right. I couldn't find him. But I know that his aunt had a little party. And his aunt got kids and stuff. So they blew up the balloon. What's those balloon where you slide down and stuff?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So bounce houses.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I had a box cutter. So I wait till they went to go eating, cut that shit open. You know what I'm saying? You hear my girl? Okay, your kids won't slide down that shit no more. So that was that. You know,
that's the only revenge you got from.
Yeah, because I didn't want to do too much because I know.
And you didn't get in trouble behind it.
That's the thing. That's why I didn't go to him, because he could have reported that to the office. Damn, you know, my granny would got.
And you at 12 at this time.
12, going on 13. Y'all see.
He beat up a 12-year-old. He beat up a little girl.
So the girl how old was she?
She was two grades lower than me.
And he should.
So she younger than you?
Yeah, she was younger than me. But she was like, she played basketball the next 2 years after that. So that's when I really had to.
Yeah, that's crazy that he would even jump on a young kid like that. Yeah.
And he was a grown man, right?
He was a grown man.
Man, that he got off easy.
Yeah, see, I ain't never tell nobody about that. I kept that to myself.
Yeah, you know? Let me ask you this, man, because being that you Yella Beezy's cousin.
Yeah, that's
cousin. So did that influence you on the rap game any, to where you wanted to rap even more?
No, see, the thing was with me.
I know you didn't end up rapping.
And when you say cousin, you mean rapping. First cousin?
He like.
Second or third, I believe.
Probably like second. Because my granny is cousin with his mama.
Okay.
So that side of the family is the Bells. That's the major. The Bells is large. His side is the Russ and the Conways. Mm-hmm. But we don't call him Yella, we call him Marquise. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's your family.
Yeah.
So was that ever something that influenced you in the music when you seemed like, damn, me making it?
No, this what happened.
Like you knew the nigga before he was even rapping.
Yeah, this what happened though. I didn't find out that he made it. Was when I was in Edward Waters College back in Florida. You know what I'm saying? I was in college at the time when he made it. You know what I'm saying? And, I used Facebook to connect with my family when I was in Florida. So I hit up, you know, my Uncle Goonie, my granny. She's like, how y'all doing? Blah, blah, blah. She's like, yeah, you know your cousin on the radio. I'm like, who? She's like, Marquise. You know that's on me? I'm like, yeah, that's him. I'm like, like, who he signed with? Like L.A. Reid. Okay. So I hit him up on this real Facebook. Like, bro, this your cousin, bro. Congratulations, you know, blah, blah, this, blah, that. I'm honoring you, you know what I'm saying? You came and got it, you know what I'm saying? You know, we still in that house off of Denley, you know, in the cliff. You know, and he said, what's up, bro? I'm going to holler at you. I guess he was busy at the time, so.
Hey, man, more money, you got more stuff to do.
Yeah.
I always been a fan of his, man. Being in Dallas and all the hoopla that go on, man, the Oak Cliff versus everybody look like, you know, because they, you know, they doing their thing over there. And the hoopla that comes with all the stuff that's went on in Dallas, what do you think about that? All the beefing and all that. How can we help Dallas to come together and love again?
Well, like you know, I'm a community activist.
Yeah.
Dallas cats. I'm going to go ahead and be real with you. I'm going to keep 100. No. Dallas cats, they really got a fucked up mentality. They don't know unity because this city in itself is more privileged and matriarchal. When you got privilege and matriarchal, you don't really create strong-minded men, you know what I'm saying? So they gonna bitch a lot, they gonna get jealous a lot, you know what I'm saying? They gonna do pity shit, you know what I'm saying? Whereas Atlanta, when you know, like the unity there, it's like Black Wall Street, you know what I'm saying? They faced a lot of shit. From Atlanta to Georgia to Carolinas, they seen a lot of shit. They're not privileged, so they had to work for it. Okay, if I'm gonna work for this, you know what I'm saying, this empire, I'm gonna help my brother out, because we can't go against them, that man, you know what I'm saying? Texas, the GOP nation, you know what I'm saying? They make the politics what need to be done, who can rap, probably, you know what I'm saying, shit, because Texas in general limit our fun, you know what I'm saying? We can't gamble, you know, all that shit. So when you put all that, look at it as political, a ghetto political way, that's what you see. I think Dallas really need to, cats need to go out and travel more. You know, mostly I say them, they need to go to Atlanta and see how brothers, you know what I'm saying, chunk $1,000, go to, you know what I'm saying, go to studio time, bro. This on me. You know what I'm saying? Instead of just our mentality, like, that nigga no $1,000, you know what I'm saying? You might run off shit. Nah, bro. Like I said, I lived in a lot of places. The unity is what need to be done. Before we do anything, we need to
unify. Well, what about Po' Boy Finance? What made you come up with Po' Boy Finance? Because you are a business owner.
Yeah. Business owner.
Po' Boy Finance. Break down how did you come up with that?
You know, the Po' Boy, basically, you know, I'm one of the low-income audience. You know what I'm saying? I'm willing to help the low-income audience. I'm basically all about the low-income end up. I'm about to low income audience. You know, for example, I'm a target of a felon. You know what I'm saying? I done seen a felon lifestyle a mile away. He can't get no job. He can't move in a certain apartment. He got to use somebody's name. What's his name? I'm willing to pull up in my car in the suit, bro. Hey, let me come. Let me book the session for you on me. I'm going to waive your fee. I'm going to waive your consultation fee. Here you go, bro. Now, let me ask you this. Put a piece of paper down. What's your position right now? Are you a pendant felon or a convicted felon? Whatever position he is. You a pendant felon? Okay, this is a spectrum right here. This is a list of jobs right here for you. I'm saying, fill this out for me. I'll contact the HR. I'll get you started Monday. You a convicted felon? Or you going to go to second chance trucking? You know what I'm saying? They willing to start you off from your CDL, blah, 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 this, blah, 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 that. Here, you got some money? Yeah, he said he got $25, $50. Go to Capital One. Don't go to First Bank. Don't go to Bank of America. Capital One got no maintenance fees. They, you know, good on the savings, you know, percentage and shit. So I'm willing to dissect the po' boy or the felon. I'm willing to dissect the felon whole background and just uplift him to make him get back on the right track. You know what I'm saying? That's how I do it. I like to really.
So you love helping the ones who
at a disadvantage.
At a disadvantage, and that's how you came up with the po' boy finance.
Yeah.
So you just try to go around all the people who has felonies or who are down on their luck, who may not have parents, and just try to help the people who don't understand the algorithm of how to make it in life.
Yeah, yeah. Where that, to start from, and you know, the right.
What made you tap into that?
You know, it's like this. When I was working my three jobs, bro, I worked three jobs, bro, at once. My motherfucking bachelor pad had the low down dirty shame poster on it and a bucket of grapes in that bitch.
Okay.
I'm saying, I'm broken the motherfucker. But me working all those three jobs, I'm putting that money up. And this guy, he noticed that I had an African chain on. He like, bro, I like that African chain. You rocking that, bro? He like, let me tell you something, bro. We are Moors. I'm like, what? We are Moors. You didn't know that? I'm like, I don't know. What's a Moor? Like, you know, I'm a knowledge seeker. I told him, enlighten me on this. Like, Moors, we once ruled the world. You know what I'm saying? We started off in Morocco. We spanned it to Italy. We reigned there. You know what I'm saying? We had infrastructure there. You know, so I'm listening to this shit. Then I do some research on it. One thing about me, you know, I do research.
Mm-hmm.
I can do a day full of research. You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? I can research your ass, you know, to the T. When I was in college, my roommate, my motherfucking laptop with the light.
What college did you go to?
Edward Waters College. Okay. I got accepted to a lot of college, but Edward Waters College in Jacksonville, Florida was the one I attended.
What did you specialize in at a college?
It was business administration. Okay. At first, I was about to go to Bethune-Cookman, but Edward Waters College gave me the better deal.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
That's what it's all about.
Yeah, HBCU all the way. Mm-hmm. You know, but like I was saying, like my laptop would have so much light while I'm doing a lot of research. My roommate like, damn, bro, this nigga up like 3 or 4 in the morning still research. Yeah, bro, I gotta do research. I gotta know what I'm talking about. I gotta know what I can put my foot in. You know what I'm saying? And I know you sleep, bro, but shit, I'm going to the other dorm room. You know what I'm saying? Get your sleep. I'm finna research this shit.
So, Poor Boy Finance, is this the company that you own solely and fully by yourself?
Yeah, sole proprietorship. This is me. I'm finna turn this into LLC. In the next 4 months.
And how long ago did you start the business?
I started Poor Boy Finances.
Because it's not only finance, you do tax services, you do everything.
Yeah.
So Po' Boy is like the big umbrella over everything.
Yeah. Because basically it's consultant, taxes, credit maintenance, financial advisory, and I'm trying to work my way up to title loans and all
that. Do you do everything by yourself or you have employees?
I do everything by myself, but I got an uncle who raised me,
mm-hmm.
who's accountant / loan officer. Who gave me key points on what I
he assists you when you need it. Okay.
Yeah. Best that's man cool. ever, man.
And when did you say you started this company?
Let's say established 2020.
2020. Oh, so it just started.
Last year, 2022.
Yeah. Okay, cool. You have a lot of clientele. How are you getting your business out there?
Uh, talk to people person to person. Like, mm-hmm. if I go to, like, Barnes and Noble, mm-hmm. pick up a book, somebody in line, we talking, I might tell them, hey, man, this is my business. You need financial advisory. Sit down and talk about it, because I just, you know what I'm saying, doing this Bitcoin, you know, knowledge and stuff. We can sit down and do this and do that. You know what I'm saying? I just go out. I'd rather go out and talk to people. 5 of my clients I got from Facebook. Okay. Most of my clients is just people I know through referrals. You know, and another thing, too, I just helped this lady out who worked in Mesquite. I set up her portfolio. She was getting scammed by this Nigerian over Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. I'm like, how much you paying this dude a month for so-called investment in Bitcoin? She's like, $380. I'm like, man, look, tell this dude fuck off. Get your app right now. Cash out, buy some Bitcoin right there. She said, I've been spending all this goddamn money, you know, and this all this time, I could have just went on Cash App and,
right.
Boy, let me get your number and stuff. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like that. I'm like I said, I research and shit. Mm-hmm. That's actually helping me help my brand up a little bit. You know,
yeah, because knowledge is power, no matter what.
Yeah.
A lot of people are too lazy to do the research, or not even just lazy, just don't have the time because they're busy with other stuff.
Yeah, man. You know, like recently, it came to my mind that if I want to take over the finance industry, I gotta have that competitive edge. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I'm just a nigga that just went to HBCU, who just remarkable in some numbers. Mm-hmm. But I'm going against Ivy League graduates, CPAs, CFLs with 20 years experience, and Goldman Sachs babies. So I got a lot of.
Yeah, because Goldman Sachs is a big company, and a lot of people go through them.
You know what I'm saying? I gotta go against them. So right. I really gotta be on my A game. You know what I'm saying? That's why I said, man, I'm willing to pay for seminars. I'm willing to pay, you know. Anything.
So where do you see yourself in the next year? I'm not even going to say 2 years. I'm going to say next year. Like, you seem like you're a person who plan everything out. So you already have things in place to set you where you need to be in the next year. Where do you see yourself in the next year?
I see myself in a building next year with the...
So you don't have a location right now?
I don't have a location right now. Okay. Well, actually, I got an office in Chicago.
Okay.
Well, it's in... How you say that city? Scumber... Illinois, it's like a suburb outside.
But nothing here in Texas.
I'm finna get one. Well, I went office, like with office in Dallas, actually, I have them go to, we book ones in virtual office. Mm-hmm. A virtual office, you can go pay for monthly for 2 to 8 hours. I do that in Dallas.
Okay.
So if you want to.
So how can people get in touch with you if they want your service?
I do give out my business number.
Which is?
469. 445-9003. Mm-hmm. That's one number. My email, qwamsley@gmail.com. My Facebook, LaQuentin Wamsley. Send me a message. I'll reply.
So why should clientele come to you over anybody else?
Because I work on a experience and personal level. You know, I'm willing to take my time out of the day to actually get to the root of your problem. You know what I'm saying? Like, for example, if you say that... you owe something in collections, I can dig into your background and see how long this been a delinquent, you know what I'm saying, and see what, give you the steps what you need to do to execute that out your credit so you
can get. But you're out. A one-man show, so how long is it going to take? But like if somebody come to you with a case,
yeah,
but you already have 5 other clients, 10 other clients you're dealing with, you're a one-man show. How long would it take for the turnaround for them to get their case worked on?
Just put it like that. Normally, that's why I try to limit my clients for right now.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So I can probably work on them the next day or in the next hour.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Because, like I said, when I told you about research, mm-hmm. I do that all day, man. I'm willing to sit here until we get this done. You know what I'm saying? Because you got to complete something until you go to the next step.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Just like you said, I got all these clients and stuff. Okay, I'm going to help him right quick. Help her in the next 2 hours. Help her in the next 2 hours. You going.
Okay. Like I just want to know. But thank you.
What's the end goal for you? We'll talk about the first quarter of next year. What do you plan to do to spin your business in the right direction going into 2022?
I want to pay for some more classes to see what the finance looking like in the next 5 years.
Because it's kind of cloudy right now.
Yeah, because
with the way the economy done with COVID and everything.
But I'm going to tell you like this. financial is finna turn digital. So we finna go financial technology. So that's what I'm gonna tell you another secret too. If you notice, they limiting banks now. So it's gonna be physical. It's gonna be very few physical banks around. Most of the shit you gonna have to go on your phone.
That's now. Why Bitcoin is so big right Bitcoin, now.
You know what I'm saying? That's one reason. But mm-hmm. they downsizing on banks. You know what I'm saying? You have money in the safe, paper is finna be as obsolete. Money paper, that's finna be out the door. You know what I'm saying? Another thing too. This is the time now where credit is finna be. I'm gonna tell you a secret. The way my formula is, your identity in this Monopoly game is not your name, it's not your social security, it's your credit score.
Okay.
You know, I'm gonna repeat that again. You can write this down. This is my Shorty 40 formula. You know what I'm saying? Your identity in this dirty Monopoly game is not your name, not your social security number, it's your credit score. You know what I'm saying? That is your identity.
I kind of agree, but I kind of disagree.
Why you disagree? Let me challenge you.
Because at the end of the day, a person that has money doesn't need credit.
See, that's what you call an elite class. But the main thing when this dirty Monopoly game is to have people, is get people to not have money. They want more poor people than rich people. You know what I'm saying? So they don't really, that millionaire, you know, status shit, that's for people who really, they choose, you know, to get that to. So don't really have to matter how hard you work. You just got to utilize your, utilize what you got, you know what I'm saying, put that to work. You know what I'm saying? For example, me, I didn't cut down on spending out on food. You know what I'm saying? I'm cooking now. As a bachelor, I'm actually cooking now. You know what I'm saying? That saved me a lot of money. Me learn how to maintenance my toilet and my tub, that saved me a lot of money. You know what I'm saying? Me, instead of going to go buy some clothes or some shoes or another gun, I paid my credit card off double that. So I'm like utilizing this where I'm not rich, I'm not poor, but I'm in stagnation for right now. While this economy going down like this, it's okay to be stagnation. You know what 50% is, right? That's stagnation.
Do you living in you used to live in California?
Stayed there for a little bit.
Go back and back forth. Did you like California?
I'm gonna tell you one thing about LA, man. I'm gonna tell you about LA and Oakland. See, my uncle's friend was from East Oakland. I first started out in East Oakland. That's like the ghetto. Like that po' boy answer, that would probably hit big in Oakland. You know what I'm saying? That Oakland's the ghetto. You know what I'm saying? Motherfucking broken down Victorians. No, they don't have houses. Everything crowded in together. It's like a concrete jungle. You know what I'm saying? Brothers selling more dope than anything out there, man. So, you know what I'm saying? They don't have much opportunities and doors than L.A. You know what I'm saying? So, it's real rough out there. You know what I'm saying? When I first noticed out there, them guys fight over turf and territory, and that pimp shit's still active out there. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm kind of like 50-50 with pimps. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm a community activist. You know what I'm saying? I'm not the right one you want to play with, bro. Like, you, especially with that pedophilia shit. Man, if I find out you a pimp and you do that shit, bro, man, it's a wrap for you, bro. Like, I might come with one Jamaican, I might come with one Haitian. See, one thing about me being like around the 40s Crips, most of them guys, we were just partners. But my blood, like, when it's time to do some shit, was a Caribbean cat, Jamaican or Haitian. You know what I'm saying? Because them the type of cats who really gonna get that shit done. You know what I'm saying? Crips would be like, oh man, I got a warrant. You know what I'm saying? They Crips ain't hoes, but they kind of trying to stay in a line, like, you know what I'm saying?
So do you glorify the gang activity?
Nah.
And the reason I ask you that is because that's something that we've been talking about here lately on the show, just how to really mend and heal our people from whether it be gang violence, whether it be for inner city violence or whatever the case may be. We're looking at ways to try to make everything better. We can't stop all the gang violence. We can't stop it. You know what I mean? But we can like you say, reshape, or we can condense it down to where somebody like you or me could speak up and change a little kid or young man's mind about even being a part of something. So, you know, something that has crippled our people, whether it be gangs or whether it be inner city violence. We're looking at ways to make things better, to change the narrative.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you something, man. I done had cats who claim, you know, they Crips, Bloods, GDs and stuff, and have no clue. If I say, bro, okay, we finna go to Chris' house, bro. You 40s, right? He's like, yeah. Let's go to Chris' house. Nah, bro, I gotta go somewhere. Where you gotta go? You know Chris, right? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. You ain't got a lot of kick it, bro. You know what I'm saying? And another thing, too, about that gang shit is that really most black males, they don't have a trade. They don't have a skill to keep them occupied. You know what I'm saying? That's one thing about me helping felons and having workshops for HBCU students and shit. I can actually sit down and have a session and pinpoint what you actually good at, bro. What you like breaking the cars and shit? You like with your hands, man, bro? Start your own. I go downtown and buy your DBA, bro. You start your own man's skill. I do that for you off of brotherhood shit. You know what I'm saying? But don't. You good at cocking a 9mm, but you ain't good at putting that 3/4 screw in that drill. Make
you gotta make money. It. Yeah, you gotta make it to where, you know, it's something where they can relate to it.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
I like it, man. I love the fact that you have a mindset to help, to try to change the narrative, man.
Man, I'm saying.
And thank you so much, man. We love you, brother.
Yeah.
What's the po' boys, man? Absolute, man.
And the black oligarchy too.
And the black oligarchy too, man. Say, man, thank you so much for coming on the show, man.
Okay, boss.
Boss Talk 101, where the bosses have talked.
Yeah.
Check it, man. It's going down, man. It's another great segment of Boss Talk 101.
And we have.